This is issue 45 of Dyke News, and there's an article here about an event that was held several months earlier at the KG Club, which was a public venue in Auckland's lesbian community, called House Antics. And it was basically an event where a number of queer households would get together and each one would organise a form of performance. So some of the acts that were presented at this House Antics event are described here. Whanganui Ave apparently gave a synchronised dancing routine. Paget Street had a musical drama. And this is a photo from a 1985 Gay Liberation March. You can see a lot of the fun that people seem to be having in these political movements. The earlier celebratory culture that had emerged in queer house parties and private spaces, and also in bars and clubs, really came through into the mainstream political movements of gay liberation. And in that sense, the private and public spaces of Auckland's queer communities were the forerunners of the queer culture that we still see in Auckland today. So this is the very first issue of the periodical Dyke News. It's got quite a number of letters that people have sent in, and one of them is a letter from a woman called Carol about the establishment of the house at Wallace Street. I'd been looking for a quiet place in the country for months, feeling freaked out because my home of 3 years was to be sold by the landlord, my security base being uprooted. I decided I couldn't bear any more my scattered city energy. Felt like being a bit more grounded, not so much caught up in the frantic round of contact that is part of our lesbian community here in the city. One of the interesting things I think about this letter is that it mentions a lot of the reasons that queer people wanted to live together. So Carol talks about the issues of people being forced to live together in crowded spaces or sharing rooms, which I think is a reflection of the general housing insecurity in this community. The 1961 Crimes Act prohibited people from providing a resort for homosexual acts, and that was something that landlords often invoked to be able to evict queer tenants or tenants who they thought were queer because they didn't want to be held liable in a court. And then of course just general social issues that might have arisen within families not accepting people and then people being left homeless as a result of that. So the Wallace Street house was in Herne Bay. It was a 10-bedroom house, 10 women moved in with one child and a number of dogs. It was basically one of a number of queer flats that existed in this time. And a lot of these houses were in walking distance of each other in the city's central suburbs, so Herne Bay, like Wallace Street, but also Grey Lynn and Ponsonby and Grafton were places where a lot of queer people would live, and then these houses would gather and socialise as well. It was very much a venue where political conversations could be had and where a lot of people would come and have meetings. And in that sense, it was a very political space. This is issue 45 of Dyke News, and I think it's quite a reflective one of what these later issues looked like. So at this time they'd started printing photos, which had presumably been too expensive to do previously. Here is a number of helplines that have been listed for people across New Zealand, which maybe shows that the publication Dyke News was starting to get a greater readership across the country, whereas it had been previously restricted to Auckland. And here's also one of the very characteristic flat advertisements, which would generally say that a space was a lesbian or a gay flat, depending on the publication, and provide a phone number. An indication of their rent as well, $30. I mean, probably a lot of money in the 80s. This is a diary, essentially a journal or record of daily events, which was kept by the owners of the Snapdragon Bookshop, which opened in 1985, also in central Auckland. Another interesting thing actually in here is a description of how they first raised the funds to open the Snapdragon Bookshop. So they secured $4,200 in grants and $5,800 in loans And that's quite a typical financing scheme for a lot of these queer spaces, which would rely on maybe community grants and government grants that were often quite laborious to get in the first place, and then also loans from private donors who maybe supported the enterprise that they wanted to open. The Snapdragon Collective also renovated their whole bookshop themselves. You can see some photos. This is a great one of after they had just ripped out everything and a woman sitting in the mess and just taking a little bit of a break before they start to put it all back together again. How much this was an enterprise that relied on people volunteering and always being present and showing up. It's not a very kind of cold business model. It's very much a space that's run by and for queer communities. So this is an article that the owners of the Snapdragon Bookshop kept in their diary. This is a picture of them. The article's from the women's page of the Herald in 1984. A store run by women, for women, with books by women writers only, will open in Auckland next month. And the omission of the word lesbian is quite interesting there, and that was something that the Snapdragon Collective later said was deliberate, because they had feared that they wouldn't be incorporated as a society if that had become public before they opened. This is quite an interesting article that the Snapdragon kept from the People's Voice. A sign saying that a certain shelf of books in the store were only available to be sold to women, and they apparently had some male customers who were complaining about this and did in fact get in trouble with the Human Rights Commission. In the photo here you can see some of the titles. Women Who Loved Women was one of them, Black Lesbians. The sign that was apparently offensive was taken down, but the policy of only selling these books to women remained. And in that sense, this queer space maintained the intended character. A lot of these spaces don't exist anymore, and you know, there might be a couple of photos of what they looked like at the time, but here you've really got a record of the process of establishing a queer space in Auckland, and also how these spaces wanted to present themselves and were concerned about how they were seen in the media articles that they kept. This is an illustration that was published in Dyke News, and it's quite interesting because it outlines a lot of the issues that queer people identified with queer spaces, particularly around the exclusion of particular groups who were not considered queer enough in these spaces, which here gives kind of a banner of the advertising of a lot of queer spaces around being inclusive and welcoming queer people and affirming their identity, but then has this list of club rules, which the author obviously perceived as the unofficial exclusion of particular groups from these spaces. So one queer space that became a central focus of these conversations about exclusion was the Alex Pub, which had been taken over by two lesbian women in 1981. What happened was a number of incidents around people feeling unwelcome in these spaces that then culminated in a walkout on New Year's Eve in 1981. The protesters handed out these leaflets, which were republished in an issue of Dyke News here. One key theme which emerges is Maori and Pacifica people who are feeling unwelcome. There was apparently one attack against a black family which was provoked by pub management and resulted in a charge of assault being laid against that family. Is having a good time more important than fighting blatant racism, sexism, classism, and anti-lesbianism? And those are the questions that queer people were starting to ask, particularly in the early 1980s. The notion of a unified queer community hadn't really emerged, but because these people had maybe felt or experienced similar exclusion because of being queer, they might have been more sensitive to a lot of these issues and perhaps also more willing to challenge that in their own spaces as well.
So the Charlotte Museum is a lesbian museum, and our sort of mission is to sort of collect and preserve and exhibit the histories of lesbian sapphic communities and lesbian sapphic women, and really the reason why the museum exists is because nobody else was doing it. It's been going now for approximately 15 years. It's pretty much everything that reflects the life of lesbian women and their communities. And so it can be something as simple as a publication magazine, lesbian magazine. We have quite an extensive badge collection. that diary that Friederike got Snapdragon Bookshop. And that's really cool because someone's put photos in there and then they've written sort of a running commentary of how they sort of set up the shop. A lot of what we've got in our research library and document archive just doesn't exist anywhere else. And it makes you realise how important it is what we're doing in terms of collecting and preserving heritage and history. Yeah, so it's pretty special.
The collection that Friederike has been using for her research is the Auckland Lesbian Archive. In 1978, there was a meeting out at Piha where it was discussed that the idea of a large women's centre be established. At one point along their journey, they decided that this information is really important and we need to keep it and we need to organise it and keep it as a complete record. A group of people got together and they got funding to do that, and they collected all of the different separate women's organisations that had ended up in this women's centre, and they archived it basically. And then it ended up coming in here. What they present ultimately is a real lived experience of the time.
It's been great to work with these archives, particularly with all of the people at Auckland Libraries who know so much about the material that they have kept and have been so helpful in finding and suggesting particular collections that could be useful. So having these resources are really important in order to be able to carry out that kind of research, but also to have the history of queer communities maintained and preserved for future researchers who are interested in different aspects of that history, particularly because it was a history that wasn't necessarily so public at the time. It's been really special to kind of be one of a number of people who are trying to re-establish and rediscover that.